Morsenal Studio B in Chandler, Arizona, this is MayaCast. Welcome to another edition of MayaCast. I'm your host, Tom Shadle.
And I'm your host, Kip Arcel.
And I'm Professor Willett.
And this is episode 287 for Friday, August 14th, 2020. Compagnia di Ventura. Coming up on today's show, we are going to be talking about John Hawkwood and the White Company. And we'd like to welcome in Professor Willett. Welcome, Chris.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
He's back to give us the historical perspective on the man that was John Hawkwood and his mercenary career. And then we'll give you the Infinity Lore perspective, and then we'll go through the new list of available units for the Sectorial and the available fire teams, and we'll talk about that since that's brand new. Because it's N4 week. It's Infinity N4 week, and so you're seeing all the videos come out from Bostria and with all the new information. And since we record earlier in the week, right, by the time you're hearing this, all of that will be done, but it's not done by the time we're recording. So since that's still coming out and there's still new information, Kip and I will recap all of the stuff from N4 week on next week's episode once we have access to it all, because we're recording on Wednesday, so we don't have it all. But yeah, so that's today's show, John Hawkwood and the White Company. And without further ado, let's jump right into it.
Infinity Archives. Would you like to know more?
And so we are lucky and privileged to have Professor Willett back with us for this episode. Longtime listeners of the show will recognize Willett coming on the show and giving us his history teacher perspective on Infinity stuff, and 90% of the time it is truthful.
I mean it's been pretty truthful.
Well, we had that one episode.
All of that was true.
With Gutierrez's notebook.
Yeah, that's all true.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But yeah, so thanks for coming on. Welcome back. And tell us all about the man that was John Hawkwood.
Certainly. So I was definitely very excited to see that John Hawkwood and the White Company was going to take on a larger role in Infinity, that they were going to actually get their own sectoral, that I started doing a little bit of research on my own, because when this all came out, people were like, ooh, the White Company? Is that really what we should be naming an army in today's day and age? It's not very PC. But the fact of the matter is that the White Company was like a real thing back in the 14th century. So as part of my research, I read a book called John Hawkwood, an English Mercenary in 14th Century by William Caffaro. So if you're interested in reading more about the guy, you can find it there. So John Hawkwood was born in England, and he fought during the Hundred Years' War. And so he went over to France, fought in several battles, and eventually came his way to Italy, where he served as a mercenary for various Italian kingdoms like Pisa and Milan. But his greatest successes came when he was in the service of Florence. In fact, the kingdom of Florence loved John Hawkwood so much that when he died, they gave him this huge state funeral with a procession and a burial with honors, which by comparison, they did not do for Dante of Dante's Inferno fame. So they loved John Hawkwood more than they liked Dante. He was married twice. So his first marriage is less well known. It's been fictionalized in various stories. One of the things about John Hawkwood is it's difficult to separate the fiction from the fact. So in one story written by a 17th century author, William Winstanley, John Hawkwood falls in love with the master's daughter, who is betrothed to another man. Hawkwood is beaten by highwaymen, left for dead, when a naked, overweight, red-haired woman appears in the guise of a ghost. Hawkwood fights a tournament against two giant brothers, leaves England for adventures, and then finally reunites with that master's daughter, who had disguised herself as a man to escape her betrothal. None of that's true. That's all fiction. Just a made-up story. But, you know, that is kind of like a testament to how larger than life John Hawkwood becomes after his death.
Kind of like where, like, you know, William Wallace shoots fireballs from his eyes and lightning bolts from his arse.
That's right. It's exactly the same thing. John Hawkwood is like the English version of that.
There you go.
The fact of the matter is that the true identity of his English wife is unknown. But what we do know is he eventually just leaves her to go on international adventures, to go, you know, sell his sword in Italy. So later on in his life, he's going to marry Donaina Visconti. She is the illegitimate daughter of the Milanese ruler Bernabo Visconti. And this was part of Hawkwood's payment for bringing his mercenaries to help Milan and Florence in their war against the Pope. So Bernabo figured that by giving away some of his daughters as wives to these different mercenary captains, it would be the best way to keep their long-term loyalty. You know, you don't have to pay your son-in-law to fight for you. He'll just do it, right? But of course, that did not work. You know, if you think about it, he's getting paid up front. Why would he continue helping this guy just because he married the guy's daughter? He has the daughter.
Right.
So the thing about Hawkwood is that he is a cunning warrior. He has a very forceful attitude. He was not the kind of guy to suffer fools. There's one story that I had told Kip about earlier where he's walking down the street and he's met by these two priests, and they say, "May God bring peace to you." And he said, "May God steal all of your alms, all of your donations." And they were just insulted. They're like, "Oh, how could you say such a thing?" And he said, "Well, why would you say, 'May God bring peace to me? War is how I make my money. So you're telling me you want God to make me poor?" And the priests were just like, "Let's get out of here. This guy's crazy."
He just outsmarted them.
There's lots of stories of him doing things like that. Once, while he was planning a battle, a Florentine politician named Andrea Vittori gave him advice. He consulted on military matters. And Hawkwood said to him, "You go weave your cloth. I'll go fight your wars." So that was the kind of guy he was. In 1379, a brigade that was under the command of an Englishman named William Gold, who was a comrade of Hawkwood, repeatedly disobeyed orders. When Hawkwood gave him orders, William Gold was off doing his own thing. So Hawkwood threatened Gold and all of his men with execution. He told them, "If you're not following orders, then I'll just have you killed." But most importantly about Hawkwood, even though he is seen as very forceful and very coarse, he's also honest. He's described as the one honest mercenary in Italy. When he took on a contract, he saw it through to completion. Okay. Mm-hmm. While some mercenaries might accept a bribe to throw the battle to the enemy, there are actually cases of Hawkwood denying a bribe that would be offered to him by Florence when he was in the employ of Milan. So even though in between contracts, his loyalties shifted from kingdom to kingdom, while he was on contract, he was loyal to the contract.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like Boba Fett. You know, Boba Fett's the same way, right?
Boba Fett? Boba Fett? Where?
So, although he received his early military training during the Hundred Years' War, fighting for England, when he came to Italy, he was exposed to the tactics of German soldiers, Hungarians, Bretons, Catalans, and other soldiers from across Europe, who would come to serve with him as mercenaries. So this kind of plays a role in, again, what Carlos was talking about, that White Company has all these different factions in it. Well, Hawkwood was exposed to all these different factions. Mm-hmm. The White Company literally was a mix of all these different countries. Now, Hawkwood's tactics, because Hawkwood, the character in Infinity, is a great tactician, Hawkwood, the mercenary, was also a great tactician. Before he escaped from Milanese territory in 1391, he accepted his opponent's challenge to a one-on-one battle. So these two mercenary companies meet in the field, and they agree to a duel the next morning. So that night, at dusk, Hawkwood picked up camp and quietly escaped through the back routes, placing his battle standards high in the trees so that the enemy would assume they were still there.
Mm-hmm.
So he bravely turned his tail and ran.
Brave Sir Robin ran away.
Right. But unlike Brave Sir Robin, he then detached a contingent of his men, placing them in the woods so that when the enemy went into the woods chasing after him, they were actually trapped by Hawkwood's men hiding in the forest. He also used spies to collect intelligence from the countryside. You know, this was one of the things that made him different from other mercenaries, is he wasn't just focused on the fighting. He gathered news by paying villagers. And it didn't matter, you know, whether the news was about what was going on in Italy, if the news was going on about what was going on in France or England, he still paid for it. So he was well-informed, used that information to pit his different employers against one another so he could get the best price. Now, the real key to success, to his success, was his brutality. So besides being cunning and smart, he was also intensely brutal, especially for the time period, which was a brutal time period of war. So his soldiers dismembered their enemies, raped women, and savagely murdered peasants. Hawkwood himself murdered a young nun while he was plundering a monastery. That's something that would be frowned upon in Christian society. There was an event where two of his officers, had gotten into a tug of war over who would get to rape an attractive young girl first. And Hawkwood settled this by stabbing her in the heart with a dagger and said, "There, you both lose."
Damn.
I know. So he's not necessarily a very nice guy. He was a mercenary. You know, he was a brutal soldier during a brutal time period. Now, he was first hired by Florence to deal with a mercenary company that was laying siege to Florence. So by this point, he had already been serving for different countries like Milan. But when he gets hired on by Florence, these mercenaries called the Company of St. George had been attacking Florence, and they were demanding 40,000 florins. Florins are gold coins in Italy. So this company was basically extorting Florence and demanding payment to go away. So when Hawkwood shows up with the White Company, the Company of St. George immediately decides to sue for peace because they know who they're dealing with. And instead of demanding 40,000, they accept 20,000 and just say, okay, let's just give us 20,000 so we're not walking away empty-handed here. So him coming to the rescue of Florence and saving them is what seals his relationship with the kingdom of Florence. Now, what ends up happening is their relationship usually consists of him almost each year demanding more money and him bringing more and more success to Florence. Hawkwood also used a strategy that was unique, which is that he used dismounted men-at-arms. So up until this point, most battles consisted of men-at-arms on horseback. So heavy cavalry smashing into each other with lances, punching holes through the infantry. But Hawkwood employed a strategy that he had seen used in France, which used slow-moving men-at-arms walking rather than being on horseback. And that was one of the things that led to his success. Now, by March of 1394, Hawkwood's health begins to fail. He's getting sick. He knew that the end was coming, like he knew he was dying, and settled his accounts, his estates, because, you know, besides being paid gold coins, besides being paid a beautiful, capable political wife, he was also paid in estates. So all these different countries he was fighting for were giving him land, giving him positions of power. So what ends up happening is he settles all of his accounts and then dies of a heart attack. And that's when the Florentines give him this huge, magnificent burial. They build a statue as a tribute to him that becomes his tomb. And after his death, his Italian wife returns to England and tries to claim land holdings that he has over there, only to find out that nobody even remembers John Hawkwood. Ooh. And that the land registers, that like the deeds and stuff, had disappeared due to the plague. So when she shows up trying to claim ownership of the land, there's nothing there for him, or nothing there for her. And thus ends the adventurous life of John Hawkwood.
Dang.
Yeah. It's a roller coaster. This could be a movie. Yeah. I'm surprised they haven't made a movie or a TV series about this guy, because it's got all the adventure and killing and epic battles,
intrigue, love.
It would be like if they took Nightfall and Turn. I don't know if you guys watch Turn, the Washington Spies. I love that show.
Yes.
I'm in the third season right now. But if you took Nightfall and Turn and then they had a baby.
Yeah, totally.
Like that would be the John Hawkwood series on Netflix.
I think as a historical figure, Hawkwood's stock isn't very high. There aren't very many books written about him. The one that I found was published by John Hopkins University. So it's like a textbook sort of thing. Mm-hmm. He's not like a great world leader. You know, he's no George Washington. You know, he's literally a mercenary, but his story would be fascinating.
Yeah. It's like the bad guy in most movies.
Oh, yeah. He is kind of a bad guy.
It's really very, very interesting, since I did the Infinity part of the lore and didn't look up the historical aspect because I left that to you. Hearing the things you say and me being like, oh, my God, yeah, because, right? So John Hawkwood served with the Pan-Oceania military, right? It's where he got his training.
The French.
That's where he put it. No, France are in Ariadne, man.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Well, not.
Pano's like.
Not
Australia
anymore.
And India and South America. So he served with the Pano military. He saw action serving alongside O-12, right, and all their international forces. So he gained much experience, but he didn't have the political connections that were necessary to advance in the Pan-Oceanian officer ranks, right? So he found he couldn't advance, and so that's what led him to decide to go private and go into the private sector and the war market. And so his early mercenary company made their name fighting in the neocolonial wars for both Pano and for Yu Jing. Just like you said, he's with Florence and Milan. He's fighting for these two different city-states, as it were, fulfilling the contract all the way out to the end and never betraying the contract. And so when he's fighting for Pano, he's completely loyal to Pano. And when the company's fighting for Yu Jing, they're completely loyal to Yu Jing until the terms of that contract are met. Got him there in with the special situations subsection of Aleph, who are, you know, trying to oversee this two-faction war that are under their auspices, right? He's very calculated, very grounded. They say he takes no foolish risks. He's a professional, consummate professional soldier. He's not some idealistic paladin out there fighting for causes. Mm-hmm. He's fulfilling his contracts and doing it very calculated, ruthlessly. He always leads on the field. You know, he's not an office. He's not a desk jockey. He's not leading from the command center. He's always out there with the troops. And in fact, he almost died during the Ariadne and commercial conflicts. So now his body is actually a lost. It's an artificial body. And because he occupies this lost, because he almost died and needed it to survive, downloaded his conscious, altered carbon, I hear, is a lot like Infinity.
I've never heard of it.
Stacks upon
reset
stacks.
Reset the clock. So because of this lost body, Nomad's black propaganda has jumped on that. And, you know, claims that he is this illegal, unauthorized Aleph recreation. You know, like William Wallace is a recreation, like Joan of Arc is a recreation. And with the purpose of giving Aleph power and influence within the war market, the mercenary market, to further the AI agenda. He's absolutely loyal to his employers, like we said. This is where it's a little different. He's a tough leader and he's tough in the field, but he's never cruel. He cares deeply about the lives of his own soldiers, gives them the best accommodations, the best healthcare, never throws them away needlessly. Right. And he will always accept an enemy's surrender. There's never been any reports of battlefield atrocities or war crimes or anything like that. He's very honorable, which is a little different than the personality you described for us.
You know, this may be where the fictional version of Hawkwood is different from the historical version of Hawkwood, because I haven't read any of the books, but in the book that I read, they kind of describe some of the fictional depictions of Hawkwood and how he is often depicted as more gallant, more Robin Hood-like, you know, more someone to be respected, because nobody wants their hero to be someone who murders a potential rape victim.
Yes, exactly.
Well, he saved her from that. That's noble. Like,
yeah.
From a certain point of view.
But that's Gutierrez in a nutshell. Like, one of the things I like about the way Gutierrez is, like, this master historian, but in the Infinity Universe, he'll take these people that had these qualities. He's like, well, you know what? If they just had X amount more morality, or the world had X amount more morality, we would be a better, more utopian place. And we still fight each other because it's Infinity. But he rewrites it in a more, utopian, like, well, I can't be dishonorable. The world should be full of honor. And I actually like his view on the world that way, because it's kind of like, I share that. It's like, wow, well, if everybody just had a code of honor that we all stuck to, there'd be far less jackasses. They'd be the same amount. They just wouldn't be as much of a jackass because they're like, well, I have to abide by this code of honor. You know, he's done that with a lot of different
It's the idealized versions
in the Infinity Lore.
Coming out of these Florentine adventure romance novels.
Yeah,
totally.
Exactly. Because which I like that, though. I like that.
There's another book, a really great book about the Middle Ages called A Distant Mirror, which I highly recommend to anyone. And in this book, you will learn that almost all the knights of the Middle Ages were jerks. They were awful.
Yeah.
They're just self-centered jerks. And that
I am the law.
And the Middle Ages, the Middle Ages would be better if they weren't jerks, but they're not. Mm-hmm. So they're jerks. It's
but
rough.
Chivalry and gallantry.
Absolute power.
That didn't come up till actually later, after the Middle Ages.
All right, so
I was just saying, absolute power corrupts absolutely.
Totally true.
So the White Company, White Co., is it's a small company, but they are exceedingly successful. They have all these diverse elements from traditionally opposing backgrounds. You know, like troopers that used to be in the Yujing army alongside troopers that used to be in the Pan-Oceanian military complex. And they work together as one, truly brothers in arms. So they're this small, elite, traveling mercenary force recruited from the best units of Pano and Yujing with support from Aleph. And these troopers must give up their faction loyalty completely to be part of the White Company. And Hawkwood gives no second chances to his men. And by employing ex-Pano and ex-Yujing soldiers, he keeps up to date on the latest military doctrine and operations and tactics and standard practices of the modern militaries of the human sphere. Bureau Hermes, which is the Communications and Transportation Bureau of O-12, they contract White Company a lot for security among the circulars, right? And yeah, the White Company has their HQ on Svalarema, and which is a great place for them because both sides are hiring, right? You've got Yujing and Pano there fighting over border disputes and whatnot. So they're headquartered on Svalarema, where they're known as the Vitdrakten, or the White Suits. And everybody say hello to Walter. That's Willett's dog, Walter, in the background.
He is outside.
Yeah.
That is how loud he is.
And they're based at Castagnaro Base, which is this underwater fortress. And there's a lot of underwater facilities on Svalharema. There's a whole section about the freaking submarine wars between Yujing and Pano. And so this is like an old geothermic power station, along with a small submarine base attached. And it's Castagnaro Base. And they have a slave AI that runs like all the day-to-day operations and logistics with inside the base, right? Keeps everything running smoothly. Guess what its name is, Willett? It's Bernabo.
Oh, John Hawkwood's father-in-law.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
The slave AI's name is Bernabo. And so when you said that, I was like, whoa, that was great.
Gutierrez, you son of a bitch. So it did it again.
It runs, yeah, it runs all the automation for the base. It was damaged during the blizzard skirmishes, and you know, neither side wanted to like spend the resources to repair it. So Hawkwood obtains it, rebuilds it, and repurposes it as his headquarters of operation. It's super high tech. It's got the best technological advancements from both Pano and Yujing. He's got the best of both worlds. Every trooper, this is what I was saying, he cares about his troopers' well-being. Every trooper has their own room. They're not sleeping like four bunked together in a single dorm room, right? Every trooper has their own space. They have these crazy VR virtual reality training facilities that they can work in, top-notch medical care, wellness facilities. So he really looks after his dudes in his awesome, cool base. But they are Compagnia di Ventura, the venture company, right? And risky, daring journeys. So they have to have a ship, right? So they have the WCS, which I assume means the White Company ship. WCS Gringolet.
Goulet.
Sorry, when you said Gringolet, I was like, it's like the white cheddar.
Gringo L.E.T. Like. So that's like their ship, their home. Its captain is Wang Lei. They contract out with the SSS, like I said. And because of all these contracts from Aleph, they've actually established another base on Concilium called Maidan Basha. And, and Saito, Togan, sometimes works with them only on the most humanitarian of missions. But he's not in the list, is he?
No, he's not.
Yeah.
Oh, that's crazy.
It's a huge oversight.
Well, that's because he only works with them on the most humanitarian, not war. So he would never go in and, like, explosive close combat somebody because it's a humanitarian mission. And maybe he's just there as, like, the Chewbacca of the group. Like, yo, you know what I can do? So you should be civil.
It's a war game, not a humanitarian game.
But it's also a very historic game, as we've noticed. Like, one of my favorite things about Infinity is the lore. Like, how deep it goes. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people just overlook that. Like, the lore book, it's like, that's fine, it's not the rules. But listening to you, and then the links that, you know, Tom, when he does this, it's like, you have no idea what's going on in Gutierrez's head. It's amazing. Like, the lore is freaking amazing. It's probably my favorite sci-fi genre because it's not always about, like, well, we're just murdering this other people and blah, blah. There's just, it's so in-depth and it's really,
like,
really
Bostry cool. always says, we read the Wikipedia of the Iliad. Gutierrez read the Iliad.
It's so deep. It's really, really
But the good. Best the best part about looking up stuff for the White Company, which has been around since, like, as a side mention, like, as an aside in the lore, it's been around since first edition, right? Kind of like O12 has been, and then we just got the army, you know, a year ago. But the best part in searching for it was when, if you Google the White Company, the first thing that comes up is thewhitecompany.com London. And this is, like, I guess a jewelry company, or I didn't look really that far into it, but I didn't look up Infinity. I just looked up the White Company on Google, and this comes up, and the product that comes up is a hexagonal Infinity necklace, which was just crazy coincidental, blew my mind weirdness, but yeah.
So there's an anniversary gift idea, guys.
It was like a whopping $24, so you know it's super high quality. And those gemstones are totally real.
How many florins do you think that is?
At least
Yeah. So, the historical White Company was originally led by a German mercenary named Albert Sturz from 1361 to 1365. So Sturz served for a very short period of time. And then this upstart named John Hawkwood shows up. It was composed of originally German and English soldiers. John Hawkwood became the leader of the White Company when he won an election for the position in 1365. So that's the reason why he replaces Sturz. It's because the men vote for him. They choose him. At its largest, the White Company consisted of 3,500 cavalry and 2,000 infantry. Meanwhile, at its smallest, it was just 250 men. You know, and that's one of the things about these mercenary companies is that they grow and shrink all the time. You know, I imagine that these people join your mercenary company because they don't have anything else going on. And then there's an opportunity to go on crusade. You know, there's an opportunity to go join someone else who'll pay you more. So you just pack up your squire and pack up your page boy and bounce.
It was a sales role of the medieval times.
Totally. Totally.
Well, now I have enough to buy my own tavern, so I'm going to go back to my hometown and just, you know, get other people drunk.
Yeah, I could totally see some of that. Now, we don't know why they're called the White Company. One theory is because of their brightly polished armor. Another theory is that they wore white surcoats at one point. Companies were organized into lances. So the lance, a lot of times you'll hear, if you read the book, it's described as how many lances they have. A lance consists of a man-at-arms, which is like a knight, but he's not a knight. So a man-at-arms has a suit of armor, he has a horse, he has a spear, a lance, things like that. He has a squire, which is a man-at-arms in training, someone who is a teenager, you know, younger than 21, is their squire. And then they have a page, and the page is someone who's younger than 6, maybe 12, younger than 12. And their job...
I was going to say, that would make more sense.
I don't know. Riker is 4.
A 5-year-old handling my swords.
Riker's 4, and I think he could be a page.
He could go fetch an apple from the fridge.
Yeah, he can, actually. Now, here's the thing about a page. Is a page is not a soldier. A page is a he's a squire in training. His job, mainly, is cleaning the armor, cleaning the horses, pitching the tent, starting the fire. He's the camp bitch. That's his job. And finally, the final interesting thing for me, and probably what, I mean, I don't know. I'd have to ask Gutierre, but possibly the reason why White Company is in Infinity is that White Company is featured in a Sir Arthur Conan Doyle novel, which is called The White Company, and it takes place in Spain.
Aha!
Nice.
I mean, okay, there's the connection there. But then again, he's just a very fascinating character. Interesting story.
And Kip, Gringolet or Gringolet, however you pronounce it, it was Sir Gawain's horse in Arthurian legend.
Oh,
nice. Can I add a little bit of a dumb wordplay here?
Yes,
usually.
As you were talking about, yeah, I have to. So you were talking about how like the pages were just like the bitch and they handled all this like little stuff. And I'm like, well, takes many pages to make a story.
So, that was quite the dad joke.
You know, there is a very famous page by the name of Parcell.
Really?
Kenneth Parcell. He's been alive forever. He worked at 30 Rock. People that watch 30 Rock will get it.
Yeah, I was like, I have never watched 30 Rock.
Oh, you're talking about the pages that work at NBC behind the scenes. And they're like, here's your coffee, Mr. Shadle.
That's funny. Yeah, I've never seen 30 Rock, though.
It's good.
There are a lot of Kenneth Parcell quotes where he says stuff about, like, well, a Parcell man would never, that I would love to get clipped for the show.
Oh.
Because they are.
I know who you're talking about.
They are amazing. It's Jack McBriar.
Yes.
That's funny.
Oh, my goodness.
Anyway.
He's your relative, Kip.
Hey, apparently my relatives were, like, fierce warriors in England. And then came to America, and now we just make bad jokes.
So I guess that's about it for the historical and lore anecdotes on John Hawkwood and the White Company. Let us move on to the profile of John Hawkwood and then the units available to the White Company as revealed this week on N4 Week on Bostria's video on the Corvus Belli YouTube channel.
The enemy of my enemy is my friend.
If you know the enemy and know yourself, you need not fear the result of 100 battles.
Then, have they resisted, sir?
Yes. But why are they using such primitive weapons?
Now entering the war room.
All right, so now we're going to get into the game aspects of John Hawkwood and the White Company. But while we took a little bio break between segments, I looked up Castagnaro on the internet, because Castagnaro Base is their home on Svalharema, and I figure that's got to be a thing too, because Gutierrez wouldn't just make up a word. And so wouldn't you know it, the Battle of Castanaro was fought in 1387 in Castanaro. Imagine that. What a coincidence. It was between Verona and Padua. And guess who was leading the Paduan forces?
Who?
John freaking Hawkwood.
Oh, my goodness. That guy gets everywhere.
Like sand. Yeah, so let's talk about John Hawkwood, mercenary officer, the profile. He's available in vanilla factions of the factions where he gets his troops. So Vanilla Pano, Vanilla Yujing, Vanilla Aleph. And then in N4, he will, of course, be available in the White Company Sectorial Army. So, Kip, tell us about John Hawkwood.
So, Mr. Hawkwood... when he first came out, I remember there was some controversy, which apparently in his past, that was part of his whole thing. And our good old friend Tim, Mr. Chainsaw, was trying to make use of him. And it's like his points to what you get for the factions he was in. It was very hard, especially in N3. Want to see what it comes out in N4 to make him work. Now, the first thing that I want to look at is the movement of 4-4, because he is, quote-unquote, medium infantry, and we all know that in N3, medium infantry was 4-2, and with the introduction, like you said, Tom, dazers, other difficult terrain, that was like a big deal that he doesn't really suffer from that. So, I mean, that's decent, you know, the 4-4 move. He does have close combat 22. Mm-hmm. With a monofilament close combat weapon. That's not too freaking shabby. He also has martial arts level 1. But in a faction where he can fire team because he's a wild card, like that kind of makes sense because he can get to where he needs to be. He does have ballista skill 13, which is better than usual.
It's good.
Physique 11. I've played a lot of Ariadna, which they're either 10 or 11.
That's not good.
It sucks. he does have whip 14, which is better than average. If you were in Hawk, they laugh because they're like, that's normal because we have better schools than everybody. armor 3, which is decent for a medium infantry. BTS 6, which is awesome if you're getting hit with any bio munitions. He has one wound. His availability 1. So let's get into his like stats. So like I said, he had martial arts level 1. He's immune to shock and also has no wounded cap. So essentially, you have 2 wounds because you don't die or go unconscious when you take your first wound. He has mimetism.
Yeah, the big
go ahead.
The big difference between a shock immune NWI guy and a guy that just has 2 wounds is that the 2 wound guy, when he goes unconscious, you can have a doctor come heal him. Mm-hmm. And this guy's just going to be out of the game, off the table. The biggest bummer to me between N3 and N4 is in N3 he had bioimmunity, and in this N4 profile he has immunity shock. And when you have a BTS of 6 and only an armor of 3 and you get hit with shock or viral or something, bioimmunity allows you to use that BTS value instead, which is awesome. But with immunity shock, we'll see when N4 comes out, but the way it shock immunity now would not let you roll your BTS unless you're already rolling BTS because of the ammo type.
Yeah, that is frustrating because, like I said, he's already really expensive for what he is. And not having that extra, like, armor is a little frustrating, is what I saw. But terrain total, so that's the thing.
So it's multi-terrain,
Instead of having, like, multi-terrain, then you choose whatever. Yeah, it's just total, which is really cool. So, I mean, he's got a lot of gadgets. Thinking back to the history that we just went through, we went through Professor Willett's history, went through Tom's. In my opinion, he was very intelligent, which he should be like, what, 15 then? Or 16? Or have MSV to see through the BS, which he doesn't have.
You know, 14 is pretty good. And also, I'm pretty certain he was not literate.
No, okay, there you go.
But he did speak several languages. So, well, 14.
Hey, okay, so yes, in this day and age, then he is the 14. But
so he was not only a cunning tactician, but also a cunning linguist?
Yeah. That just happened. So that was the other thing. I was like, well, if he was that good with 14, I would like to have seen him with some sort of strategos or the fact of...
Or like lieutenant plus one command token.
Lieutenant level two. Yeah.
Lieutenant level two.
Any of those lieutenant skills that exist that this amazing tactician guy just doesn't have on his profile, except for whip 14 lieutenant.
Yeah, exactly. Like, that bugs me. You know, and the other thing, I was like, well, if he doesn't have any of the strategos or the command tokens, then he should have counterintelligence. But we know that Tao Wu's available, and knowing the real history, when you're saying he was kind of a savage, cracks me up, because it's like, well, maybe he made a deal with Tao Wu, and that's why he was so good. So he needs Tao Wu there for his extra abilities on the command side of things. Because he might not be as good of a guy as we thought.
What do we think the odds are? Because we're looking at his N4 profile in Pano, right? Not his N4 profile in
It's just his
White
basic.
Company.
It's his basic N4 profile. I mean, N3 pro. I mean, well, this is his N4 profile, which is the only thing different.
I'm looking at.
Go ahead, Tom.
I'm looking at N3 in Pano, and I'm also looking at the one from Bostria's video. Which is his N4 profile, which has the three basic profiles we have in N3 Pano, but then it also has both weapons, K1 Marksman Rifle and Red Fury, as the lieutenant option. Mm. And he can only be the lieutenant in the White Company sectorial.
Okay, that's right.
So I'm pretty sure this is the full profile. I don't think we're going to get any special surprises when White Company goes live.
Which is... But like, that might be his lieutenant option. Is like, he might be the only zero SWC lieutenant in White Company to force it.
That, for all we know, that very well could be, and that makes him more attractive, more valuable. Instead of wasting SWC, you're just wasting a chunk of points. Well, not wasting, but spending a chunk of points. Although, you know, 40 or 41 points, 40 for the Red Fury, but it costs an SWC, 41 for the K1 Marksman Rifle, zero SWC. Both of those in White Company can be the lieutenant. And then add chain of command, it's a whopping 45 points. He is pretty durable for all of that. He is armor 3. He's going to be armor 6 in cover. He's got the no wound in cap with the shock immunity. He has mimetism to help win those face-to-face roles. He's pretty... He seems a little expensive. And like I said, would have liked to see some of those lieutenant abilities on this amazing tactician. Mm-hmm. But, you know, he's not... He's not a glass cannon by any means.
No, I bet he does shine more here than when you were trying to take him in just vanilla. And I do want to say this. I love that he has to be tied to Tao Wu for that counterintelligence because, as you said, Willett, you were like, they were known as the White Suits. When I saw that Tao Wu was in here, I was like, well, maybe that's why they went with that white suit camo. Which is really
the Vitrakten,
right? Before I get into the other, so with troop selection, it kind of blew me away when I first saw this video today, because this dropped today. I was like, wow, this is like all the hyper powers you have. Freaking Pano, Yujing, Aleph, plus, you know, one unit from O12. It's ridiculous. And then you're like, oh, they're supposed to be the best mercenary in the game, so we'll throw captains in there. I was like, what is going on? This is insane. But after hearing the history lesson and then Gutierrez version, it makes sense, which is really awesome. Which brings us to the special profile, which is the special instructor and Aristea Swordmaster. Shona Carano, which was a new profile. We knew this was coming from some teaser art, but her profile is pretty freaking sick. So, granted, there's only one, We only see one that we know of. It's 27 points, 0 SWC. And what do we get? A 4-4 light infantry movement, close combat 23, which is awesome because she has martial arts level 4 and an AP plus explosive close combat weapon. That screams to me Templar. For any of you McMurrow folk, that's really freaking insane and disgusting.
And she's physique 14 on the profile.
I was gonna say BS 11.
So what is that?
Don't care.
17 with the martial arts.
Yeah, with martial arts, that's 17 damage, 17 armor piercing, plus 3 armor rolls. It's freaking crazy, amazing. I personally like the sculpt. I know some people out there are like, well, I can't wait till the normal one, but there was a gentleman, and I really am sorry because I wrote down the name and then left it on a different notepad, on Facebook, who was like, pointed out that this is a homage to a lot of the saints' pictures that were slaying dragons. Willett could attest to this, and I'll probably have to do something on our Facebook because I wrote down the name. I can't find the paper that I wrote down on when I was in my office, and I'm really pissed about that because I was like, yeah, it's exactly what it is, and I love it. Freaking looks good. I love the sculpt. She's whip 13, which is, well, for Pano is good, but for everybody else is normal. Arm 2, BTS 3. You know, she's a close combat powerhouse. One wound, but she has no wound in cap. The one thing I don't see here is shock immune, though. So you have to keep her safe. Like, that's the... But she's only 27 points. And you also...
And she has frenzy.
Yes, but we'll get into other things about the frenzy later. She also does plus 1 damage to her close combat. So that's actually 18? Or did you factor that in, Tom?
Did not.
Yeah, close combat attack plus 1 damage. So 18! That halves your armor and is...
Three dice. At half armor, at damage 18.
She dodges on a 17 because she has dodge plus 3. She also dodges an extra inch. She has stealth and super jump. I hope the jump rolls are different in 4 than they are in code 1 because super jump is not my favorite. I don't think that it's great. I think that it's good if you're coming off of a roof, but not getting to somebody.
I think they're going
to
be exactly the same because Heloise and Bostry and everybody else keep saying that what you learned in code 1, you will be able to apply in N4.
So super jump is awesome if you're on a building. Getting to somebody, super jump now sucks. Unless you have a really good weapon, which she is armed with a submachine gun and nanopulsar. So not a gunfighter at all. She might be able to shave off a couple inches here and there with the movement on the super jump.
She's a sword master.
Yeah, she is a freaking tank powerhouse. And I think she shines more on her ability to fire team, which we'll get into. But I mean, those are pretty much like the two new profiles, because we talked about Tao Wu when he came out and we saw that.
The Swordmaster will smash whatever she gets into base contact
with. Yeah, exactly.
what does the new martial arts level 4 do? Do we remember? It's from code 1.
Plus 3 to your attack, minus 3 to your opponent, and then plus 3 damage.
Okay, yeah. So not the plus 1 burst?
That's martial arts level 5.
Yeah, it got bumped down. So that's the thing is, and then she has plus 1. So she's basically plus 4 to her physique. So it's an 18, damage 18. That's disgusting.
It's icky.
Yeah, and it has your armor.
If she crits, you're making 4 armor saves.
Yeah, exactly.
It's pretty awesome. I like her a lot. I mean, she's kind of like mini Achilles in a way. More squishy.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, for sure.
She's very, very squishy.
But killer. All offense.
Yeah, but it blew my mind. Like, going to the White Company, like, the available units, I'm sitting here thinking, wow, this is probably the most interesting mix of units I had ever seen for a quote-unquote merc company. You have all the hyperpowers, but it makes sense after you were talking, both of you, you know, you showed us the history. Regular Hawkwood was, you know, England, Germany, Italy, all of the major, France, all of the major powers in England. And like Tom had said in the Infinity, Europe, I don't even know what I said at that point because my phone shut off and I was trying to get it back on. But as Tom said, like, you know, it's based where Pano and Yu Qing are at each other's throats. Aleph's always looking for a way into making humanity its slave because Aleph's the real enemy. You know, Aleph's like, oh, yeah, I got your back. You get Kaplans, which have always been one of the best merc options in the game. And people are like, why is it only available in QK? They're amazing. And they look like stormtroopers. I want to do a Star Wars army. And then you get the O-12 aspect, Fringians.
True. Kaplan, by the way, is Turkish for tiger. You may recall we went over that during the QK episode.
That's why they have tiger soldiers then, because that would make sense.
It's on theme.
So, yeah, getting into that, it blew my mind, like, looking over this, the White Company, and I'm just going to just breeze over it, because I'm pretty sure you guys saw the video, but, you know, you have your total availability, Fusiliers, okay, oh, it's a Pano army, well, the next thing is a Danavis hacker.
Well, and let's, one thing I wanted to say about that is, they're not Fusiliers, you're using the Fusilier profile, they are White Company infantry. They are probably retired Fusiliers.
Thank you, Tom.
But they are not, it's not like Fusiliers direct from Pano that come over and he's using them. No, this is a mercenary company. They're, you know, retired or, you know, what's the other, discharged, you know,
not happy,
that have hired on and are loyal to the White Company and to each other. So it's not a Fusilier. Mm. It's a Fusilier profile representing troops of those abilities.
So I like that you said that, because that's kind of what I was going to get at the end. But that should actually be there, because I do like that. This comes with, this kind of plays into like the proxy rules, right? To where you can make your own company nowadays. As you noticed, I mean, Tom and I have been working on freaking Mandos for almost a year. And that's what it is. You're like, well, it's the profile. So, yes, they have the quote-unquote Fusilier profile as their base troop. But they're just whatever. I mean, those, they're just better trained, whatever line troop you have. The Danavis hacker blew my mind because...
Hello, White Noise.
Yeah, that is probably one of the best hackers in the game. So you have that available. Two CSU units, which have a special fire team we'll get into. That's insane. Up to 5 availability Kaplans. I was like, okay, that works. Oh, and you're going to add Nokkin in there? Okay, so we're playing Pano. So we're going to give you one of the really cool new units. But also 2 Tiger Soldiers, because I guess we have Kaplans, and that means Tiger in the language of John Hawkwood, so we're going to give you 2 of the best jump troops in the game. the Karu Special Team, availability 5, which I'll get into later in the duos. Hideouts are 3, and they're wild cards. 2 Nisseis.
Yep.
Which will come into play in about 5 profiles. You have up to 5 orcs, up to 4 Jujaks, only 1 Guilang, but that's because you have 2 Nokkin.
Yeah.
But hey, guess what? You get 2 Guija. Dude, it's like, what the hell? Okay, so we'll give you that's a decent tag. Guijas aren't bad.
It is the base model.
Yeah, I know, right? 2 Varangian guards, and this is where it gets interesting, because you have a heavily lean to Pano profiles, and you're giving this army smoke.
Yeah, baby.
I've gone through 2 profiles, the Haidao and the Nisei, which are kind of a pain in the ass to deal with. Now you give them more smoke. Or the Nisei. The Nisei itself.
It's the first and only thing I noticed. Like, I noticed it and then stopped even thinking, because I saw Niseis and I saw Varangian Guard, and I said, So I'm going to take a Nisei HMG with MSV2 and the Mimetism -3, and I'm going to be able to throw smoke for them with Varangian Guard and shoot through smoke with my MSV2 HMG. I'm going to give you a negative 12, and I don't even need cover to do it. I'm going to outrange you. I'm going to have Mimetism. I'm going to have negative 6 for shooting through smoke. I don't even need the cover. That's going to be... And not only that, so you also have the Hideout MSV2 Sniper.
Yeah, exactly.
2-wound Sniper with MSV2 that can shoot through the Varangian smoke. Like, that's brutal. I can't wait to field White Company and show people why you don't give Panos smoke.
Exactly right. And like you said, it's not even in a fire team. It's scary. And I do love what Sectorials bring is their fire team ability, which we'll get into in a minute. But, you know, you get one Zanshi Yisheng.
It's like a portmanteau.
Doctor. Yeah, exactly right. You get your mech engineer, Zanshi. Not even to say that one.
Gongcheng.
But here's what scares me as well, right? So, luckily they didn't give this faction a Rushi. I almost said the F word. That was really funny. This faction a Rushi. Because it's like you're already adding smoke to Pano. Thank goodness you didn't go with Yu Jing remotes, because a Rushi would make it even more disgusting. But you do get all the Pano remotes. So you have your Pathfinder, your Sierra, your Clipper, your Fugazi, which... Wait. What did you say, Willett? What's our availability?
3. Fugazi.
Fugazi. So that's 21... Wait, no.
That's 24 gotta be the entire reason they use Pano remotes instead of Yu Jing remotes is because...
Right, because of Fugazi.
Because John Hawkwood fighting in Italy. So you had...
That's right.
They had the Fugazi.
Oh, man.
But yeah,
just three orders for 21 points. That's awesome.
No Rushi, but I'll take my ODD Bulleteers, thank you.
That's the next one, yes. You get your Bulleteers and your Peacemakers. Those are just as scary, because there is a lot of aggressiveness to this list if you look at it. And that kind of coincides with the Historic plus the Infinity version of Hawkwood as this aggressor. You would want the bots that start in the middle of the field with your heavy shotguns and heavy flamethrowers and the bulleteers, you know, and the ODD bots with the Spitfires shooting through smoke, you know, like are getting smoked out while they get to where they need to. But then Yao Zhao's for your pal bots, because, you know, we're a mix, we can't be biased, so we'll give Yu Jing the Palbots. You know, John Hawkwood's there, Lin Kai's there, Kunai. We talked about Shona. The two interesting ones are like Valeria, who just, hey, I'll hack for anyone who pays me.
Another excellent hacker. Yeah.
She's really good. Valeria's awesome. Use her a lot in Druze, but it's funny because this is the mercenary company, right? So, of course, Valeria's like, pay me, I'm there. And then Tao Wu, because John Hawkwood, you know, sold his soul.
Mastermind and schemer.
Schemer.
So it's just so freaking interesting. Like, you have a huge mix of the two hyperpowers of our game coming together. But after hearing the backstory, it makes sense. Yeah. So, like, going into that, like, seeing the video today, I was like, well, every sectorial, the first thing everybody looks to is, why do you play a sectorial? Because of fire teams. We're going to have less availability of troops, but what does this bring? What kind of synergy does this bring? So, going to that next slide with what Bostery had is, you know, I went to the cores. Okay, so your cores, you have 3 cores. You have Fusiliers, Kaplans, and Orcs.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you have freaking Pano QK now, which is insane. And it's funny is I don't even really look to the Fusilier cores because of other options. Like, so your Fusiliers,
I do.
Yeah, I was just gonna say
they can take up to 2 Orcs.
I would say they take up to 2 Orcs on the specialty, but also can have CSUs join them. and the CSU's availability. It's only two, but they have that metachemistry and sixth sense level one. So they can bring extra attributes to your basic 12-point, like, combi rifle model, right? Well, do you want to take a basic Fusilier, or do you want somebody that has, like, better armor or whatever you freaking roll? So it's not too bad. It's not too shabby, especially with the fact of the wild cards that you can add to it. So you have your Fusilier core team that can take up to two orcs. CSUs can join because they just can up to two.
I mean, that two wound ballistic skill 14, well, ballistic skill 17, burst 5 HMG, mm-hmm. and then padded out with 10-point Fusiliers, that's just brutal, that orc HMG. Oh my gosh.
Plus, CSUs have two amazing models. Mm-hmm. The guy with the jacket that has the hound tooth and lining. Uh-huh. He's amazing. And then there's also the girl, came out several years ago, who has a briefcase machine gun.
Uh-huh.
I don't remember where
that's
she
came
from.
That's my Bonnie and Clyde team.
Operation Ice Storm pre-order bonus model.
Yep.
Yeah.
I got one years ago on eBay, and I'm glad I got it then. She's amazing.
Yeah, that was my Bonnie and Clyde CSU's, authorized bounty hunters.
Mm-hmm.
In my Drew's force for a while. But yeah, like, I mean, that's your hey, I'm gonna take three cheap units and drop a bunch of stuff on orcs. Which, again, like, that's an option. It's really freaking cool. You have the Kaplan Corps, which is really interesting to me because those are your mimetism models, right? Mm-hmm. Like, they have mimetism. They are... I have, like, 9 tabs up, by the way, for the White Company in Army. I texted Tom earlier. I was like, man, I had, like, 6 tabs up, but then I had to do a couple of wikis as well. But, yeah, the next one was the Kaplan Corps, which was always a fun thing in QK, but now you have it in White Company as an option that also can have those CSUs join. As well as Ling Kai or Shona.
Or Jujox.
Or Jujox. Yes, Jujox as well. Which I kind of like. I like the Jujox with the Kaplans because the Jujox are kind of like the Kaplan lights, in my opinion. Honestly, is what I put them. Like, because, they bring, like, the heavy flamethrowers. I actually have them a little bit later on the duos for that role in the Haris. But they're allowed to be joined by CSUs or Jujox. And, like, the core's cool, but I would want to fill them with these other roles to make them cheaper. Mm-hmm. Because you're looking at 23 to... 30 points.
Yeah, they're expensive.
Per model, and they're only one wound. They don't have anything to keep them up other than mimetism. So, like, in this day and age,
yep.
Back in the day, the Kaplans were like, oh my gosh, they're the best. But nowadays, you're like, wow, well, nothing else kind of keeps them alive. Well, what keeps them alive here is being able to put a 12-point freaking CSU in there, and then some Jujox for their heavy flamethrower action. I don't know. I just, with the core team, I, like Tom said, I'm actually leaning towards the, like, the Fusiliers and Orcs. I'm trying to let everybody shine here.
You've got your, like, Varuna Nightmare team of a core of, they're not, you've got your core of Fusiliers that you can put an Orc in, and you can put a high Dow MSV2 sniper.
Mm-hmm.
It's even worse than the Kamau, right? Because it's got the two wounds. And blah, and then your Varangians throwing smoke for it to shoot linked through. Come on.
Well, yeah, that was the next thing I was going to get to, because, like, the third core team you have is the Orcs that can take Jujax, but really you want to go back to the Fusiliers because it's the Fusiliers with up to two Orcs, but then you have an availability 3 of Hidal. And just like you said, you can take your orc or two with your hideout MSV2 and run it up real cheap with either Fusiliers or CSUs, and that's your Fort Kickass models.
Mm-hmm.
And we had already talked about Nisei's that have MSV2 that can back that up with the other one. You have an orc in there with an HMG. If somebody pops white noise, it can help you out. You're like, well, I can still see you, and I'm in a full 5-man fire team. So that actually scares me the most for a core. Like, the Fusilier core team is the scariest with those mixtures. So right out the bat, you're like, wow, that sucks. So then you go to Hari's, though, and there's only two. You have Kaplan's and Orcs, both AVA-5. Which is pretty fun because you have people that are just like, hey, I want to do some themes. There's a scenario to where you literally, if you're like, hey, I just want to run a Kaplan-themed army, you can run, you know, a full core, a Hari's, and a duo, because duos are, you can run as many duos as you want in a sectorial. Because you're AVA-5 Kaplan's, but they can be joined by Jujaks and CSUs. 4 Jujaks, 2 CSUs. So essentially, you could run, you know, a core of Kaplan's mixing in the CSUs and Jujaks, a Hari's of Kaplan's mixing in Jujaks and CSUs, and then a duo whoever is left over, which would be really funny. I saw that just running the numbers, and I thought that was really funny. I don't know how tactically sound that would be. But with, like, what we just said with the Fusiliers and the core, the Kaplan's have a really interesting, like, Hari's option, because you can run the Jujaks with them and a CSU to make them cheaper. And I mean, what they really bring is, do you want a Spitfire? Do you want a Specialist? Because they have an Engineer and Doctor option at Whip 14, which is really, really nice. So you could run a Gunner, which I personally would run a Spitfire. If I was going to run a Hari's, I would run the Spitfire. Which can be your Harry's option. You have to pay half an SWC, but most people pay 1.5 SWC for a Spitfire. So you're not taking a tax for it, which isn't bad. You take the Engineer at Whip 14 or Doctor, whatever you want to take, depending on the mission. And then you can freaking throw a CSU in there for 12 points.
If I may.
That's not bad. Go ahead.
So the Engineer profile looks like there are two. One is Combi Rifle Adhesive Launcher D charges for 27, or Combi Rifle Blitzen for 27. Adhesive Launcher is the right choice, right?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, because it also has D charges.
Yeah.
And I mean, Blitzens are cool, but it's a disposable too. So, yeah, EM's awesome and all, but what does it do? It immobilizes things.
You immobilize
isolate things.
You glue down the tag, and then Shona waltzes up.
Yeah.
Touches it.
No, that's why I like the adhesive version better, because it's like the Blitzen's limited.
And touches it.
Yeah, I
and
mean
it goes kaplow.
John Hawkwood too walks right up. Slice and dice.
That could be your Harry's. Shona, John Hawkwood, and the Fire Team Harry's Adhesive Launcher.
Oh, man.
Combi Rifle.
No, it could, because, like, so the three models that can go into any Fire Team that you want to do, that means Core, Harry's, or Duos, is Hideout, any of the Hideout, which are availability three, Hawkwood, or Valeria. Shona can go with your Kaplan's, like we're talking about now, or Varangians, which I like her better. So yeah, I mean, like, you could do the Shona in that, because you're like, I'm gonna go up and glue something and let her run. That's actually something I didn't even think about.
Then you leave your Varangians as free agents so that they can throw smoke without putting the rest. Like, if they're part of a fire team, they put the rest of their fire team at risk to throw the smoke cover. But if they're separate, they can throw smoke to cover the advance of that Harry's to deliver Shona and Hawkwood to do their crazy, insane close combat nonsense.
So that's actually funny that you said that about the Varangians, because I think that their duo ability with and I'll get into that in the duos, because the other Haris is orcs. So here's the thing with the orcs, and I'm gonna ask you guys, because with the orcs it's like, it's basically, yeah, you could run like your availability, you know, you have five, so you can make it work. They're another one of those that have a core and a Haris with, you know, the Jujax and the Hideout availability three. You could do a theme with that, but it's like, I don't feel like that's like something you would want to do necessarily.
It's expensive.
Yeah, it's super expensive.
For the Fusiliers of heavy infantry.
Yeah, it's cool that you have that. And like I said, there you have Orcs, AVA 5, Jujax that can link with them that are fours. Three Hideouts plus the Hawkwood and Beleria, like, you can do that, but I just feel like it's not the best, like, to go there, but it's available. Going into the duos, though, like you were saying, like, one of my favorite of the duos is the Varangians, for what you were saying. Okay, you have...
Why would you give up the free order by putting them in a fire team? They're impetuous. Why would you?
They are impetuous.
Yeah,
but they can.
Don't put them in a fire team.
Because, here's the thing. Okay, let me make this argument to you. When you're impetuous, you have to move your full movement value towards the nearest enemy. So you may get that free order your turn one. But somebody who is like, oh, I'm going to deploy this. What if you're playing like U.S. area? And like, oh, I'm going to blow this out of it. And you have to run in and you get a sniper that kills you turn one. So you're actually losing.
They're not extreme, Kip.
Oh, that's right. Okay. Yeah, but like after turn one, like there's ways that people can position to force you to not use that free order. So then you lose it. So you could either look at it as like, well, I have three free orders a game, or wow, I got out positioned, now I lose three orders a game. But when, so here's the, what I'm trying to say is, if you can duo them, when you do use their order, they move with somebody who can work with them. And like, what my thing was I like them with Shona. Because if you don't want to put her with a main fire team, you have smoke cover that can move and throw smoke, because you're not, sometimes you don't want to use your impetuous order. So it's a Shona delivery system, or a Hideout specialist, because your Hideout doesn't have smoke. So now you're teaming up with somebody to be order efficient, because the whole thing with fire teams is order efficiency. Like, how can I be order efficient? So you have your cores, you have your Haris, and what are my duos? Like, moving other people up with them after that free order. So yeah, you get one free order per turn, but then after that, they only get to use one order per model. So yeah, you give up one order, but if you use three orders on that Varangian guard, yeah, you gave up one, but you gained two, and over the turn over three game turns, that's six orders, and you might have only lost two. So it's, you have to think about how much you're going to use that model, because yeah, you give up one impetuous order, but if you know that you want that thing to charge, you might use four orders in that turn. You move two models with those four orders and you give up one, so you have a net of five plus. That's the way I look at it. So it, if you don't want to use it that way, then fine, yeah, run it as a single, but they have the duo with the wild card for that reason, because over two turns you might actually be able to move things with four extra orders per turn if you need to, two models.
That's a really good idea. I could definitely see myself, if the Varangian guard's a little further up and it's time for me to now unleash Shona and she's going to go karate chop someone in half. I could see her running up to be close within 8 inches, spend a command token to duo them so she can bring this guy along. He can throw the smoke, you know, out of line of sight, you know, where your target is, so that you both can run up in the smoke. And wouldn't she get plus one burst from her buddy close combating somebody.
That's why I said she has a close combat delivery system.
Yeah.
Yes, you would get plus one dice. But the other thing I was trying to say is, like, the hideout hacker, right?
Yeah.
If you just run, yeah, you get your impetuous order and you run and throw smoke, well, you only have smoke in that one area. Whereas if where that Varangian is running with your hideout, you can smoke out multiple areas while using those orders to get where you need to be. Because if you just throw one, okay, that was my free order. Well, now I'm moving my hideout. Well, now I need smoke here, so I have to spend extra orders to run that Varangian over to throw smoke here.
Yeah.
So yeah, I've been lit up for saying, well, you're losing one order per turn. But honestly, if you plan on moving that model plus the smoke 2 to 3, maybe 4 times per turn, you're actually gaining more movement, more smoke per turn than losing out on the impetuous order, because they're moving together. Yeah. And in missions like supplies is one of the things, like, where you might need to use it multiple times. So, I mean, that's the only thing that I could see it worth it. And I actually like it in that instance.
So, I was definitely very excited for White Company. This morning I kept on updating Facebook. You know, yeah. Cosmofloat. That's cool. Where's White Company? Where's White Company? I want to see it. This is what I was really excited about. And I actually love this array of units. They're all new sculpts, or they haven't been sculpted yet, some of them. And if you have Operation Caldstrom, then just the regular one, but not the Beyond. If you just have Operation Caldstrom, that gives you 3 Fusiliers, Noken, Guilang, Jujak, an Orc, and Liang Kai. So just having that box alone gives you a bunch of things on the list. Mm-hmm. And my only regret when it comes to White Company is that I already painted 30 Pano models during this pandemic. And they're all blue. And I was just thinking to myself, gosh, wouldn't it be cool to have an all-white, you know?
White Company?
Yeah, with like white Svalarheima Nisei's, white orcs. My orcs are all bright and blue. Yeah, white drone bots. I was just thinking to myself, wow, that'd be so cool. But, you know, I already did all that. So now I might have to make blue Yu Qing models. That'd be funny. Blue tiger soldiers. That's actually probably what I'm going to end up doing. Just so they all match.
Make the other guys blue?
Yeah, so they all match.
The all-white thing would be cool. And it makes sense, too, because it's where their base is. It's where they started taking the contracts between Yujing and Pano. So it makes sense that those units from Svalarheima feature prominently in John Hawkwood's company.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so a lot of interesting things. We'll see how everything really fits together once we get the full army list, when Army N4 Army updates the free online app. Carlos said in the first video this week, he said end of September for the PDF rules, the free PDF rules, and for the army update should be the end of September. That's where we see how everything really fits together. But a lot of cool profiles, a lot of interesting things, and we'll see if we can ever get Shona, John Hawkwood, or Liang Kai into close combat all the way across the table. But like I said, all I'm really interested in is having a Nisei paired with smoke, and that just makes me happy. This is why you don't get Pano smoke, guys. It's going to be brutal.
This conversation can serve no purpose anymore. Goodbye.
So that's going to wrap up episode 287. Yeah, 287. Compagnia di Ventura. We want to give a big round of applause and thanks to Professor Willett for coming out with us on a late Wednesday night and sharing his expertise and knowledge. Thanks.
it was just nice to talk to my buddies, honestly.
Yeah, man. Pandemic. Dang.
Yeah.
So the last thing we want to remind everybody about is our painting competition for quarter three of 2020, the MayaCast Master Glass. So tell us all about that.
Well, I'm glad that you asked. The MayaCast Master Glass, quarter three, the theme is girl power. So Tom and Kip want you to show them your ladies, your female miniatures. So all the, you know, Shona Corona. Is that her name?
Yeah.
Okay.
She might not be out in time.
No, probably not. When you email them, they want you to relabel your photos to things like Chip Rothwell 1, Chip Rothwell 2, Chip Rothwell 3, and that you have to share a before picture of the model, maybe when it's primed or built, with some sort of date, maybe like a newspaper, kind of like a ransom note sort of thing. And you're going to email them to tom@myacast.com and kip@myacast.com and willett@myacast.com. And that's it.
Yeah, and you have till the end of the quarter, which is the end of September. So right about when N4 drops is when the contest is over. And then we give the engraved master glass to the best painted entry. But then all the other prizes we give away, and we give out, the more entries we get, the more prizes we give out, all the rest of the prizes are randomly drawn. So you have to play to win. But everybody's got a chance to win blisters and boxes and MayaCast tokens and all sorts of different cool stuff. If you won last quarter and you haven't gotten back to us with your prizes, please do so, because we're still missing three or four people. It'd be great if we could get those ordered. Everybody else's, we stopped waiting for everybody else, so we ordered today. We ordered all of the rest of the prizes for those of you who did get back to us. So go listen to, I think it was episode 283, where we listed the winners of the previous Master Glass, and we gave out a ton of prizes. So get back to us with what you wanted. And if you already did get back to us, those have been ordered today. They should be here like Monday, so they should go out by next Friday. So you should see them soon. Thanks for listening. Again, we'll be back next week with all of the N4 hype, going over all of the Bostria videos. I'm really looking forward to the seminar, the Gen Con / Interplanetario style seminar that should probably have already happened by the time this releases, but really looking forward to that. Hopefully there's a lot of cool new renders and stuff and information in that. And Kip and I will be back next week to talk about all of that cool stuff that we learned from N4 week. So make sure you get your pre-orders in for N4 so you get the pre-order miniature and the exclusive miniature and all that cool stuff. And if you can pre-order it from your local game store, do that. Support those guys so that when this national nightmare is over, international nightmare is over, you still have a place to go back to play, which is a long way of saying what I say every show, and get out there and support your local game stores.
To find out how you can support the show, go to patreon.com/MayaCast.
You can find us online at www.MayaCast.com.
We are on Facebook at facebook.com/InfinityMayaCast.
Follow at MayaPodcast on Twitter.
Join the MayaCast forum group on Facebook.
And as always, you can email us at tom@myacast.com.
And kip@myacast.com.
Hello. Thank you.